I'm starting a little series today, Light of the World. And I think in a very dark time in history, in which morality has such an onslaught of deception and confusion, it is so important that we realize there's light for the world today. There's light to bring hope to people that they can come to God and that He's available to them. And my scripture for this series is from John chapter 8, verse 12. Jesus spoke to them, to the crowd, again saying, "I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life." The simple message for today, and I think it's important that you understand what is the particular message for today. Next week, I will show you from Scripture the difference between the darkness and the light and the darkness, and how we go from darkness to light through Jesus Christ. But today, I want to simply, in a nutshell, show you the whole divine purpose of the light. What is the purpose of the light? The purpose of the light is simply to live in fellowship with God, who is light. You see, we forget sometimes what God is, and then we're trying to find Him and have a hard time trying to find Him. And the best thing to do, friends, when you have a hard time to find God, is simply open your Bible. David said in Psalm 119, verse 165, "By the opening of your word, light comes." Light, he says in Psalm 119, verse 105, "on your path, like a lamp to your feet, the word of God." It lightens up where I am. Where am I standing at the moment? Where am I? Many people don't realize where they are in their relationship with God until there's more light. And the light is important. I remember as a young boy that I suffered with horrific fear of darkness. And I have a lot of compassion on some of our youngsters that maybe sometimes are a bit more adventurous when they go to church, because when I was a youngster in church, they gathered clothing, secondhand clothing for people, and they stored them in a room. And we got all the clothes out and made a mountain and dug a hole under it and made ourselves a hut. And we would hide in that hut and forget the time. And then we would think, "Oh my goodness, what time is it?" And we go and everybody was gone and all the lights were out. And in those days, the floor was of wood and went down to the only door that was open back there. So there was no other way but having to walk through that main hall that seated about 800 people. And I'm walking and you on the floor can hear it squeaking and you can hear your own steps. And I had this horror that I was being chased. And of course, the faster I walked, the faster I was being chased. And when I was running, somebody was running after me. But that was all imagination. And it's amazing, when you live in the dark, you can run from nothing and run to nothing. And the Bible says that you can't see over what you stumble when you're in the dark. That was very real for me. Thank God I'm free from any fear of the dark. But the interesting thought, and I'm going to mention to you in a minute, is that people sometimes are afraid of the light because of what might be exposed. So what is the most important thing for you to hear today? And I mean what I'm saying with all my heart, not to be afraid of the light, but come because of who's inviting you. It's the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the light of the world. And He says, "Follow me." And He brings you into fellowship with the Heavenly Father. And He begins to show you, you have nothing to fear in the light when you have Jesus. Because His blood removes every stain of guilt and shame in the presence of God. But you do have to choose to follow Him. He invites you, but you have to choose to follow. He doesn't force you to follow. He doesn't make you follow. He invites you, but you have to choose to follow. And listen to these thoughts. The life is an aspect of his being. This is 1 John chapter 1, verse 2. It's an aspect of his being. And it was revealed, made manifest, demonstrated. And we saw as eyewitnesses and are testifying to and declare to you the life, the eternal life in him, who already existed with the Father and who actually was made visible and revealed to us, his followers. If you want to know, Pastor, if I am to follow Jesus and to live in the light of God's presence and live in fellowship with him, what am I to expect is going to happen to me? What should I look for that should happen with me? Look at Jesus. You see what it's like. You see how wonderful it is to live in the light. You see how wonderful it is to have fellowship with the Father, to be able to cry, Abba, Father, to be able to say, my Father loves me, my Father is with me, my Father is in me, my Father enables me, my Father shows me, my Father teaches me, my Father instructs me. You read it in the Gospel of John, the wonderful fellowship Jesus has with the Father. That's what he's inviting you to follow him into that same life of fellowship. And friends, this is so essential for us today. Follow him and begin to live in that fellowship. What we have seen, John says, we ourselves heard, is what we're telling you, so that you too may realize and enjoy fellowship as partners and partakers with us. And this fellowship that we have, which is the distinguishing mark of Christians, is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ, the Messiah. We are now writing these things to you so that our joy in seeing you included may be full and your joy may be complete. This is the message of promise which we have heard from him and are now reporting to you. God is light. And there is no darkness in him at all. No, not in any way. So if we say we are partakers together and enjoy fellowship with him, when we live and move and walk about in darkness, we both are speaking falsely and do not live and practice the truth which the gospel presents. But if, listen now, but if we really are living and walking in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have true, unbroken fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses, removes us from all sin and guilt, and keeps us cleansed from sin and all of its forms and manifestations. Now, if we say we have no sin, refusing to admit that we're sinners, we delude and lead ourselves astray. And the truth which the gospel presents is not in us. It does not dwell in our hearts. But if we freely admit that we have sinned and confess our sins, he is faithful and just and true to his own nature and promises and will forgive our sins, demise, our lawlessness, and continuously cleanse us from all unrighteousness, everything not in conformity to his will in purpose, thought, and action. Now, dear friends, the best place to live while we are in this body is in the light of God's presence, where the power of the blood cleanses you and keeps you cleansed and makes you aware if things need changing. Do you know there's a lot of people who don't have a healthy self-awareness? They call themselves Christians, he says, but are still living in the dark about their behaviors, about their thoughts, about their choices, about their manners, about their wordings and ways, and they do not have a healthy self-conscious that goes, I don't feel good about this. I don't feel good about it. They don't have that. Why? Because they're living in darkness still in the day-to-day living. Oh, dear friends, Would you be free from all defilement and corruption? Would you be free from anything that separates you from the conscious knowledge of your loving Heavenly Father? Draw near to Him with a true heart. Oh, and He will cleanse it by the Holy Spirit with His precious blood. He will remove anything that hinders your fellowship with Him. He Himself, Jesus, is the great highway of holiness. He is the one who opens it into your heart and brings you into that knowledge of God. And He will not fail you. And if you say, yeah, but Pastor, you don't understand. My failures are so horrific. My past is so horrific. How can I? Do you look at Calvary and see how He suffered? And then it will show you how committed He is to save you and that He has paid everything necessary to help you come into fellowship with God. He becomes the new life-giving way. Why would you think we would love Him from eternity to eternity? Because He loved us and gave Himself for us. What motivates us to live a life pleasing to God? Because He gave His life for us. Oh, dear friends, the power that's drawing you to come to God is the Lord Jesus Christ Himself. And I think about a man that we all know about. His name is Nicodemus. He was a Pharisee. I really do believe that Nicodemus was sincere. I really do believe that. I believe he was very sincere. But he was religious. And I would assume that there may have been parts about his religiousness that would not have been easy for us to bear. Because you see, when you have religion without relationship, it can make you hard about what you think is right. And it can make you insensitive to what is not right in you, where you're not aware of it. You see, without living in the light of God's presence, you do not have the kind of self-awareness that God wants you to have. That kind of self-awareness that makes you draw back from what is not good and draw near to what is good, where the light is truly good and the darkness is truly evil, where sin is wrong and righteousness is right. And Isaiah warns us of those who call the light, who call that which is in darkness light, who say, no, it's all okay. Friends, we need God. Religion without relationship will never be able to help people get free from what's wrong. It will only cause them to feel they can never make it. It takes the love of God to give you the hope. He can help me. He can change me. He can deliver me. He can heal me. He can restore me. We need this for ourselves so that we can have His love and faith for others who seem impossible in their ways. I mean what I'm saying. You can see when your own heart needs a greater revelation of the love of the Father when you don't have it for others. But the more you live in fellowship with Him and the more He reveals His love inside of you, the more you begin to bear that love for others. And you know what He's done for me, He can do for others. Oh, what a joy when you have this faith. When people come around you and instead of feeling, oh, I better not say anything here, they know about me. Oh, I better not look at them or they'll try to talk about it. And people shy away from connecting, from communication because things are not right. But people should come among us and feel that feeling. Wow, I can be open here. I feel love. I feel hope. I feel forgiveness. That's Jesus. He is light for every one of us in whatever level of darkness we live. And I encourage you, keep coming into the light. Keep bringing it into the light. You may say, but Pastor, what if I see things that are not right? How wonderful to be able to say to your wonderful, loving Savior, oh, Lord, I see these thoughts in me. I see these ways, these reactions, these attitudes, these thoughts, Lord, they are not right. And I repent of it. Make them right, Lord. Live in my heart by your Spirit. Cleanse me with your precious blood. Friends, it really feels good when you can make things clean and when you can make things right. You'll love it. It is the greatest joy of salvation that we can come right with God. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Nicodemus came to Jesus. And Nicodemus recognized God was with Jesus. He recognized it. And Jesus said to Nicodemus, Nicodemus, what you see in me, you cannot have within yourself unless you have a new birth. Unless you have a new birth. And Nicodemus couldn't connect with that. He said, I'm an old man. You mean I've got to go back to my mother's womb and have to start all over again? I know there's a lot of people, listen closely, who would say, I wish I could do it over again. I've been one of those. Yeah, we'll be married for 42 years in April, and I've many times thought to myself, I wish I could go back 42 years with who I am now and start again. But okay, everything becomes new every morning by the mercies of God. His mercies are new every morning. So I'm not going to live in what coulda, shoulda, wisha, woulda. I'm going to live in what God gives today. And I want to encourage you, don't live in the coulda, wisha, woulda. Live in the today of God's goodness and mercy. Could, wish, I would. That's all that was too quick. And here, Nicodemus, this religious teacher, he came to Jesus. There are people that have good religion, but they don't have a living relationship. The relationship is the light. You can have perfect religion and still be completely lost and not have that healthy self-awareness. And I'll show you what it is. Emmanuel, God with me, his love, his kindness, his goodness, his forbearance, his long-sufferance. Oh, friends, God doesn't want you to have that kind of self-awareness that you always feel bad about yourself, that you always feel ashamed of yourself, that you always feel you're failing and falling short. That is the life of sinners. No, he wants you to have that awareness of his love empowering you to love as he loves, his kindness empowering you to be kind as he's kind. Wouldn't that just be the joy of your life, that you can feel your Heavenly Father living in you and living through you, to those in your own household, to those who are your neighbors, to even those who are your enemies? Nicodemus didn't understand any of these things. He had no conscious knowledge of what was possible in fellowship with God. He had religion. He had religion. And thank God, he came to Jesus. And Jesus said, Nicodemus, you got to have a new birth. He said, I don't understand. He says, it's like the wind. You can hear it. You can see its movement in the trees, but you don't know where it's coming from, where it's going. So the Spirit of God comes into you to give you life. He still didn't understand. He said, remember, Moses lifted up the serpent on the stick in the wilderness, and anybody looking at it was healed. So I must be lifted up that whoever believes in me will not perish, but have everlasting life. He couldn't get it completely. And I want to pick it up in verse 15. Listen to this. Whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already, because he's not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world, and men loved darkness rather than the light, because their deeds were evil. Everyone practicing evil hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his deeds should be exposed. But he who does the truth comes to the light, that his deeds may be clearly seen that they have been done in God. Do you see what Jesus is saying? You can come out of the grip and the forces of darkness into this fellowship you see I have with the Father. It's the love of the Father inviting you into it. And this is what you'll receive if you come. you receive new life, freedom from the forces of darkness, freedom from the guilt and shame. As you come, you will feel there is no charge from God against you. There is no condemnation from God against you. If you have me, I am your redemption. I am your salvation. If you have Jesus, if you have me, Jesus said, you have no condemnation. How simple can it be, dear friends? What do I need? Jesus, we sang about it this morning. What does the church consistently need? The revelation of a living Christ bringing into a living, life-giving fellowship with the Heavenly Father, where we enjoy this fellowship. It's real to us. It's not just us coming to God, but it is Him coming to us. Oh, how wonderful when you feel the Spirit of the Lord coming to you and you respond. And you respond. You respond. When you were not wanting to come into the light, you would not respond. You maybe didn't realize why you didn't respond, but you didn't want to come clean, is what Jesus says. Come on, folks. Let's come clean. Come into the light where the Holy Spirit cleanses you from any consciousness of sin, that you may love to serve the living God. We want the light in our homes, don't we? We want the light in our relationships, don't we? Well, you don't have to walk around with some kind of little know-it-better spirit that makes others feel criticized. How about believing that your loving Heavenly Father knows how to bring things to a point of change? How about believing? And I'm not saying never say anything, but I'm also saying don't every day hammer away at something that the Holy Spirit needs to work. Have this spirit of faith. The Heavenly Father will work. I believe in this with all my heart. And I'm so grateful to be married to somebody who believes in this. And when I was a pastor, a young pastor, I had lots of passion. I had lots of passion and zeal. But I was blind as could be. Blind as a bat, they say. And Virginia was living in light that I didn't even know yet. And I was having attitudes that were hard for her. Really hard for her. And I was just stupid about it. And then she would go in the bathroom and she would just pray and worship and pray. And she would come out of the bathroom with this love, this life shining from her. And she loved me. And God gave her the faith that He gave Abraham, that God would make me. And we were singing about being in the potter's hand this morning. And I tell you the truth, out of all the things that I love and admire my dear wife for, with all my soul, for this I love her the most, she never gave up faith that God would make me. Psalm 100 verse 4 says, it is the Lord who has made us and not we ourselves. If you, like Nicodemus, need a bit of remaking, like the Lord said to Nicodemus, Nicodemus, if you want to experience what you see in me, you need to be remade. Because your mindset is so indoctrinated and is so blinded to what this fellowship you see in me is like, you with your religion, you can't connect with it. You need to have a new birth by my Spirit coming inside of you. I will work it in you. I will form in you the life I have with the Father in heaven. You will enjoy the life on earth that I have with the Father in heaven. And that brings me to the closing verse that I love deeply. It is Colossians chapter 1, verse 12 and 13. Colossians chapter 1. Giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us, made us fit or made us worthy to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of His love. Conveyed means what? He carries you. He carries you. You know, Billy Graham went all over the world, and they always would bring the service to a transition by singing, "Just come as I am, without one plea, I come to thee." And the choir would sing it, and thousands would feel the welcoming love of the Heavenly Father to come to Christ and let him come in their heart. If you listen to Billy Graham's sermons, he was preaching often to Christians, people that had religion, but didn't know what it meant to have a relationship. Friends, this is what the Father gave his Son for, to have a personal relationship with you and me. That to him is more important than you crossing every D and dotting every I. That's more important for him, that you live in a personal relationship with him. What am I to do to have it, Pastor? Keep coming to Jesus. Lead me, Lord. Guide me, Lord. Teach me, Lord. I trust you, Lord. Here I am. I'm yours, Lord. I want to know this fellowship you have with the Father. The Bible says in Titus chapter 3, verse 4, when the kindness and the love of God our Savior appeared unto us, it was not by any righteousness we have done that he saved us, but he saved us by the washing of recreation, of being reborn and being renewed by his Holy Spirit, whom he gives to us generously through Jesus. Friends, it's not just a one-off. Yes, it starts there, but then every day this life keeps coming into us, this life of fellowship with the Heavenly Father, not as minister, as bishop, as prophet, as teacher, as whatever. No, as children of God. As children of God. You know, I'll close with this little story with you. I started preaching in 1978, and I was invited by a youth group in Amsterdam. I was just 18 years old, and my hair was still pretty wild. And anyway, I drove over there. I come into this little hall. They're sitting in a circle. Okay, they were ready. I stood up behind the pulpit, and as I stood there and looked at them, I choked. I didn't know what to say. Seriously, I mean, I didn't know what to say. And they could see it, you know. So some started giggling a bit, and some started praying. They may have regretted that afterwards. But anyway, because I preached for 2 hours. Anyway, but I was standing there, and everything, listen now, was screaming in me, walk out the door, get in the car, and just leave. Seriously. Everything was screaming in me, walk out of the door, get in the car, and leave. I stuck my hand in my pocket. I could feel my car key. Just get in the car and drive off. Come on. And something in me, it's, I don't know. To me, it's Jesus. I don't know what you may think it is. To me, it's Jesus. But in me, no. And when I said no to that strong feeling of leaving, this fountain of heaven opened up. And my goodness, the Holy Spirit began to move through me and bless those precious people. And that night, driving home, I was singing and praising and singing. Why? I was experiencing the light of God's life bursting forth in my innermost being. Oh, I was so in the glory, and I had a vision. And I think the vision happened like that, but it felt long. I had a vision, and I saw myself walking into heaven. And the light of heaven was like wind, and it went right through me. It was glorious. And I'm walking in this vision into heaven, and I look And I see multitudes in the darkness. And I look and I see multitudes in the darkness. And I began to weep and weep. And I said, no, Lord, no, Lord. I don't want to go to heaven alone. No, Lord, no, Lord. And the vision went away. And I ran to my father's office. Thank God he was still there. It was Saturday night. It was 1 o'clock in the morning. I ran to my dad. I said, Dad, Dad, I've got to preach. Dad, I don't know what to do. I don't know how to preach, Dad. I don't know what to do. But I can't go to heaven alone, Dad. I can't go to heaven alone. I was crying my heart out. I'll never forget it. And my dad said to me, he said, I had an invitation to a Bible school. It was, what, November then? He said, but it starts in January. I said, I'll go. And by January, I was in Bible school. And this is why I'm preaching today. About you going to heaven with me and me with you. Shall we go to heaven together? Shall we go to heaven together? Do you know the way? Do you know the way? If you know the way, let me show it. See your hand if you know the way. Tell me what's the way. Jesus. Jesus is the way. And he does not wait until you get to heaven before he comes to you and introduces the loving Heavenly Father to you and in you. And if you say, but Pastor, I'm like a Nicodemus. I got so many. Don't worry. The Lord can handle it. Maybe others can't handle it, but the Lord can handle it. Virginia knew in the beginning of our marriage, if she would start chipping away at that which needed dealing with in my life, there would have been nothing left of me. But she knew it took a divine hand to bring me to where I am today. And I want to encourage you today, that divine hand is the Spirit of Jesus Christ coming inside of you day and night, transforming you and conforming you to himself. And you will be radiant with his glory when you stand in the Father's presence. And you will have nothing that you will be ashamed of or afraid that he would chide you of. There will be no charge against you. Jesus paid it all. Shall we stand? If you say, oh Lord, I need to come more into the light. I don't want to live in the dark in any form or fashion. I want to have your holy, heavenly self-awareness. I want to be aware of your love in my heart, your long sufferance, your kindness, your forbearance, your goodness, your sweet temper. I don't want to have rage and resentment and anger. I want to be kind and gracious, but I can't do it without you, Lord. Put your hand on your heart. Don't stay in the dark. Come into the light. If you come into the light, then you don't be afraid and tell the Father. Tell him this. Say this after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I repent of all my sins. Forgive me. Cleanse me with your precious blood. I want to live in the light of your holy presence. I want to live in fellowship with the Heavenly Father. I'm yours, Lord. Save me. Now, Heavenly Father, I pray for each and every one of us that your Holy Spirit draws us up day and night into that wonderful union and communion with the Father that you live in, Jesus, that you've given us. And I thank you, Jesus, that the light that you command to shine in our hearts will never diminish. No, it will only grow brighter and brighter to the coming day. And we thank you for your love for us in Jesus' name. And everybody says, amen. God is good. Amen. All the time. Yeah, we love you. And I look forward, if possible, for you to join me on Wednesday from 7 to 8 and next Sunday morning. Have a good day, everybody. Thanks for coming.